All to the second lecture in the AAC lecture series. It's great to have everybody here. Almost a packed house mid-semester. Quite an achievement. We have another great speaker, introduced by our first speaker. Again, we want to thank the AAC for funding the lectures this year, as they do annually. We've had a great time hosting Thomas Kelley so far. He's been able to work with graduate students as well as undergraduate students in his time here so far. And we're very grateful for the funding provided. Without further ado, I'll let Tom Leslie introduce our guest speaker.
Well, thank you so much. It's great to see all of you here, and it's a great pleasure to introduce Thomas Kelley tonight. Thomas Kelley grew up in Canberra, Berlin, Warsaw, Tegucigalpa, Oxford, Lima, and Washington, D.C. Qualifications enough. You'd want to hear from anyone with that background. Previously, Thomas has worked for Future Cities Lab in Virginia, and for Brazil Arquitectura Studio in Sao Paulo, and more recently collaborated with Jimenez Lai in Chicago. He's also worked in the past for Asymptote Architecture and SOM Chicago office, and his work has been exhibited in New York, Chicago, Sao Paulo, and Rome, among other places. He's currently the undergraduate studio coordinator for the University of Illinois Chicago, where he is a clinical lecturer. And he works in a design collaborative based out of Chicago and New York under the pseudonym of Norman Kelley. He was also the 2013-2014, one of the two 2013-2014 Rome Prize recipients in architecture, which is how I know him. The Architecture Rome Prize, that's a serious Rome Prize, right? Historic Preservation Rome Prize is one of these. Architecture's really serious. And getting to know him, I found his work consistently provocative, challenging, mind-expanding in all the right ways. It's been a real pleasure to see him interacting with our students in the graduate seminar yesterday, and then today with James's studio. And his work interrogates drawings both as objects and as practices. And this kind of return to drawing, this return to an interest in representation comes not in a sort of shallow way that we're maybe used to associating with questions about representation, but in a really deep way that starts to get at what's actually going on in our mind when we represent architecture and when we understand it. So will you please join me in welcoming Thomas Kelley.
Hello? Is this too loud? Is that okay? It's okay, great. So thank you, Tom, for the very generous introduction, and thank you to Iowa State University for generously bringing me to Ames and hosting me for several days, which all of which have been very, very great. Like, it's my first time in Iowa. I'm just very happy to be here to see a good friend and to make some new ones. As Thomas said, I oftentimes have to clarify one thing before I start speaking. The NK stands for Norman Kelley. I am a partner in a practice, a very young practice, mind you. We've only been around for about 2 years. My partner, Carrie Norman, works out of New York, as Tom had mentioned, while I am based in Chicago. So all of the work I present tonight, in addition to showcasing some student work, along with some collaborative work with other colleagues, is all shared. So it's all done under this name. To begin, so when I first started teaching in 2009 at the University of Illinois at Chicago, which has been my home for 5 years, still is today. I'd be asked to teach a summer course. It was kind of a quality control type of course called Tune-Up. At that time, I was only teaching undergraduates, and I would be asked to come in for the summer to teach graduate students who had done less than satisfactory in their studios. And they were given a certain amount of time to come in, and I would help them rework their projects, both in terms of representation and argument. The second part is a little bit more important. So there was this one time where I was in a crit with a student, and we are a couple days away from this final presentation, and we are tackling the big question of her project, essentially what's at stake, how are we going to reframe your project, and I'm kind of going through some precedents and some kind of modes of how she might tackle a representation of her work. She stops me dead in my tracks, and she says, just stop. All I want to do is sound cool. Whoa, right? I couldn't think of anything more superficial at first hand. And then I stepped back, I thought about it a little bit more carefully, and I think there's a rational, let's say, understanding that came about. It wasn't so much about her wanting to sound cool, as it was her fear of saying the wrong thing. And this is super common, not just in architecture, in most disciplines. Being wrong is something all of us share. Right now, you can hear my voice trembling a little bit. I'm nervous of saying the wrong thing in front of an audience I respect. Worried that you may not like me or the work I present, but to avoid saying the wrong thing, we as Norman Kelley often say the other thing. Not quite the opposite, that's different. What I'm talking about is more of an unsettling, kind of rattling, sometimes contrary to a preconditioned belief, sort of wrong. But it's not so much about being a contrarian. I think contrarians are mean, and I think being nice is in. But rather, it's about being counterintuitive. And I think that's an important word we'll go back to through the course of this lecture. And for an architect, more specifically, this means seeing what the other guy tends to miss, paying attention. So over the past 2 years of starting this practice, I've only been around since about 2012, my partner and I have begun to consider architecture through that lens of counterintuition. Working through a set of counterintuitive positions, which I'll present to you in the format of two and three-dimensional projects. But before that, let me just run you through how I got here today. So part of counterintuition is you can't talk about just counterintuition, you need to be specific. So 2 years ago, we framed that argument through the lens of error. I was a Rainer Banham Fellow at the University of Buffalo, and we asked a series of architects and theorists to come together to define what error meant for architecture. Was it possible to discipline error, or is error impossible? Is it all glitch? Is it amateurism? Is it about a total disregard for formal or material tolerances? Or is it an ethical question? Whatever the case, could it still retain things like precision? Last year, while at the American Academy in Rome, along with Tom Leslie, it was about looking closely, and that was my pitch then. So by sidestepping architecture's obsession with close reading, I wanted to explore the value of things like 15th century visuality in architecture, borrowing from people like Bramante and Alberti. By describing architecture as a game of visual effects that absolutely required the cultural baggage of cliche visual gimmickry like trompe l'oeil and forced perspective, could architecture produce fast and even frugal cultural effects? Most recently, just a couple months ago, it was about magic. So for the Architectural Leaves Prize of New York's young architects, we presented our works in three acts. So again, we're constantly shifting the way we frame the work, borrowing from from Michael Caine's monologue in Christopher Nolan's film The Prestige. Essentially, the work was framed in three acts. Act one, we take something ordinary or normal, like a top hat. In act two, we make that top hat extraordinary. Maybe we pull a rabbit out of it. In act three, and this is the most important part, we bring it back to normal. This is oftentimes referred to as an architectural faux pas. You're not supposed to talk about formulas, right? Or else we're in Christopher Alexander land. That said, for us it was the opportunity to reconsider how through the lens of something like magic we could kind of revisit counterintuition. And perhaps through very practical and pragmatic modes, we might be able to mine fantastic possibilities. But tonight, we're going to avoid error. We're going to avoid looking closely. And we're going to try and frame everything through Eyecon. Obviously, those things will find themselves riddled throughout the entire work. But this is the word we're going to focus on tonight. It's not Eyecon, it's Eyecon. So tonight's lecture was advertised as a lesson, you know, where I would share with you some what was it? I think deceptive drawing techniques. So an easy way to consider that, let's sidestep lesson, maybe consider it more like a game. It has rules, but no real winners or losers. At first glance, it's all method, all craft, technically precise, I hope. But if you pay closer attention with your eyes rather than your ears, you'll realize that it's not that technical. It's also nothing new. We believe it's borrowed largely from people like Roy Lichtenstein and Robert Venturi and Denise Scott Brown. They played a similar game. But we hope it's framed a bit more obviously, literally even, as if geared toward a child by a child. I think some might perceive this game as being ironic, a gimmick to just get you to pay attention to our architecture. And indeed, it is a form of irony, I believe, or we're starting to come to terms with that. But not a condescending form. It's more situational, rather a series of events where we attempt to reverse your expectations. Tonight, largely everything will be about drawing, but sometimes these drawings become three-dimensionalized. But in essence, it's all about drawing. So to begin, Eyecon, this term you see above you, above me, has two definitions. According to, is that looking okay? Yeah. According to Jacques Lacan, this first definition of Eyecon is what separates us from animals. While animals are attracted to superficial appearances, like my dog thinks painted dogs are real, and he really likes to lick painted dogs, humans are enticed by that which is hidden. We like to go behind the curtain. So to unpack this further, we need to go back to the 5th century BC, where in Pliny the Elder's book, Natural History, he recounts a rivalry between two painters, Zeuxis and Parrhasius. As the story goes, Zeuxis pulls back a curtain to reveal a painting so lifelike that onlookers gasp when birds pecked at its grapes. However, when Zeuxis tried to push aside the cloth covering Parrhasius' painting, the fabric turned out to be the painting itself. Provided Pliny's account is true, this is one of the first successful instances of trompe-l'oeil, or trick of the eye, in which the painted object deceives the observer into believing it is the object itself. And this would continue through the classical world, through the Renaissance, where interiors would break out in exteriors, and eventually it would fall out of favor. It would become derided as a means of disassociating classes, as a means of exhibiting power, and using craft and visual shams to embarrass non-elites. But I like a different definition, and in fact, the term finds its origins in a far less antiquated manner. An icon, the term itself, is picked from Hillel Schwartz's The Culture of the Copy. And it is used to refer to a North American hunting tradition of crafting wooden bird decoys dating back to as recently as the 19th century. These icons are sometimes are called confidence decoys, as they were not replicas of the species being hunted, there were those too, but rather replicas of other species placed among the decoys of the birds being hunted. so as to, and this is a phrase I love a lot, so as to float a familiar scene. So imagine there are fake mallards being used to lure a heron. There's just so much preparation that goes into this, we can't help but become fascinated by this, this definition. Not only was the hunted target in focus, but so is its immediate context. It is here where our architecture begins to take shape. I think it's a less prosaic anecdote. Here we begin to, I think, reassess the value of visuality in architecture. And like the hunter, prey on you, our observers. I think to further unpack tonight's game and this definition of icon, we're going to limit ourselves to this very fundamental, very basic spectrum, courtesy of Robin Evans. At its most stripped down, architecture may be limited to three variables: drawing, building, and vision. Out of thinking and imagination comes drawing. Drawing is then used to construct a building, and finally, the building is relayed to our eyes via projection, otherwise known as vision. In this scenario, vision is the first valuation, or rather, excuse me. In this scenario, vision is the first valuation of a building's meaning, yet comes at the end of the job. But in our eyes, vision takes precedent over drawing and building, or image and object. So here we see the sequence modified: vision, drawing, and finally building. And while architecture can most easily be thought of as existing between two worlds, a culture of drawing and the practice of building, it is the optical conceit often left to do the heavy intellectual lifting. And whether it is simple as Bramante's desire to make an abbreviated nave appear longer, or as grand as Robert Barker's knack for travel and time replacement with 360-degree panorama buildings, it is fair to presume that vision is architecture's enabler. And most importantly, it enables the observer, you all, to act as the intermediary between image and imagination, building and drawing, reality and representation. Your eyes are the gatekeepers. So the only thing I ask of you to reconsider tonight is that for the next 40 minutes or so, let's see, yeah, about 40, that we privilege vision as the first instead of the final valuation of architecture. And you'll see, hopefully, that new possibilities might arise. Of course, it is not the only valuation for things like good or bad or wrong and right or whatever sort of architecture you please. But it's about focus and providing less distractions. And it actually makes more sense if we consider it mathematically. So consider those three terms again: vision, drawing, building, through the guise of a single point perspective diagram. On the left, we have a single eye or standing point observing a pyramid or building at the far right. In the center, we have a picture plane that intersects the sight lines emanating from the eye onto the actual pyramid. If we consider this to be architecture, then there are only a limited number of variables to consider. And through the next few projects I'll show you, hopefully we can unpack those together. So we begin with vision. So I'm going to show you some two-dimensional work that lends some clarification to what I mean when I talk about vision. And this is how our practice tends to begin both the act of drawing and the act of building. We like to procure and re-examine visual games. Although you might call these drawings and they're presented as such, we like to classify them as exercises or experiments, one-liners, if you will. Because they inform us, myself and my partner, how you all look at the world, as well as ourselves. They're kind of like eye exams, but far from scientific, and they enable us to study our audience's visual habits, like attention span, depth perception, to establish new visual regimes for moving forward in our two- and three-dimensional works. So the test is going to start now. If the lights were dimmer, this might work better. But let's focus on the slide, and now try and defocus. Relax your eyes. Relax your eyes until these two dots form a third dot in the middle. Raise your hand when you see the third dot. Great, that was pretty immediate. Fantastic. This is what we deem looking closely. And it's a technique, it's a really silly technique, that those kind of annoying 90s magic eye posters utilized. They actually never worked on me, so it's actually more interesting to kind of study the pseudoscience that goes on behind constructing one of these images, which are essentially a repetitive pattern, a two-dimensional pattern that is meant to mask or camouflage a three-dimensional object. So I think if you look closely at this in a similar way, you might see a sailboat or something else. So the official name for this form of image is called the auto stereogram, or single image stereogram. So in order to perceive 3D shapes in these types of images, you need to overcome some of the kind of automatic coordination that happens between your two eyes. And in many ways, you need to lose binocular vision and kind of privilege each eye individually. Some of these drawings or images are kind of perceived by just going cross-eyed, perhaps. All right, so to get on with it. The first exercise we'll show you is an exhibition of 140 postcard-sized drawings we showed at the University of Michigan in the spring of 2014 for an architecture collective we're a part of called Possible Mediums. Which brings together largely academic architects practicing in UCLA, Michigan, University of Illinois, Chicago, and now Syracuse University. So if you look at the image with text on the left, you might find a B located somewhere within the field of A's. And right now the image is far too low res on the right to understand what's going on. But needless to say, the idea was to produce 140 seemingly identical drawings and locate one drawing that reversed your expectations. So here you see the A and the B. The image on the left was repeated 139 times. And essentially it's a view from inside of a bell tower. Modeled after Giotto's bell tower in Florence, just similar proportions, looking out at itself, but rather itself in another state, a state of decay. And then for image B, that notion was reversed. And so upon getting closer to the field of 140 drawings and paying attention, you may locate the inverted image. Sort of like if any of you are familiar with like Agnes Martin's paintings, to get them, you gotta get really close. This would be kind of closer to what we refer to as a one-liner. This is the way we sketch. And it's here important to address, let's say, how we distance ourselves from optical art, in that we like pictorial representation a little bit more. And so this image, kind of like a flat totem pole, allows your eyes, I think, to move up and down to piece together a story. And we liken these exercises to, let's say, like Chris Ware's New Yorker covers, in which a cartoonist who is more familiar with addressing a narrative through a series of frames or pages is forced to condense the narrative into a single image. Another one-liner, and this is when things get kind of fun. We're kind of working on a book right now that does this, where we mine drawings from projects and try to recontextualize them by studying things like projection style. So here we take a cluster of prickly balloons from another project, which I'll show you in a few moments, but kind of decontextualize them from the project that they're attached to and basically just kind of study their projective qualities. So it may seem that this type of geometry is refusing to oblige to any projection view. A little bit longer of an eye exam, I would say, happened last year at the American Academy in Rome. And here we see a 1920s patent drawing for a toy cabin by John Lloyd Wright, the son of Frank. John apparently didn't realize how good of an idea this was, so he sold it before he made any money, and we now refer to it as Lincoln Locks. In many ways, it was an opportunity for us to expose our interest in patent drawings. John's patent was three-dimensionally modeled and incorporated some interior furniture to lend like a Laurie Simmons quality to the image, to maybe defamiliarize the scale. But like a patent drawing, it uses the exploded view to illustrate basic connection types and expose part-to-whole relationships. But unlike an exploded view drawing, where explosions are usually driven from the center and parts are exhibited at equal distance from one another and from that center, think of Tom Main's 2468 house. The explosion is driven by light and a single light source, which is kind of masked by some of the logs. So it's no longer a line drawing, or an exploded view line drawing, but rather a chiaroscuro exploded view. More importantly, though, and that's like patent drawing and exploded view stuff aside, the drawing's riddled with errors. So things like bad texture mapping, misalignment, pixelization, and approximated curvature. All of these things are embedded into this drawing. But you wouldn't know because the drawing was designed to be exhibited at an A4 scale. It's just shy of a letter size scale. I didn't have letter in Rome. So at that scale, those errors are somewhat masked. And the drawing was framed and exhibited in a gallery. This is pretty exciting for us as our first like legitimately framed drawing and exhibited in a gallery, so we had some fun with this. Also, there were like nice artists around us. But the way the exhibition was curated, you'd first walk into my studio and you'd be shown a blown up version of that drawing, so 100 A4 drawings, where we would ask you to, or not ask you, but encourage you to come close to the wall and observe those errors, so at the wrong scale. So you'd get close after looking beyond the fact that it was printed very cheaply on my inkjet printer. You start to take in things like, again, the approximated curvature of the petals, or lines not quite lining up with geometry, or kind of the pixelization I had mentioned. I think the important thing to understand is kind of with these studies, we don't necessarily know when we're making them, how they might translate into something like a drawing or a building or a drawing for a building. They're essentially meant, again, like I had mentioned previously, they're meant to be experiments for us to collect a series of observations about how we look. So next we're going to sidestep to drawing and maybe get a little bit more into these deceptive techniques that I should be teaching you tonight, or bad behavior. I think the way we conceive of drawing is essentially it's often used to represent something else. And in many cases, all of those studies revolve around that interest. They're also centered on an interest in representation and beginning to contest, let's say, standards of representation. So for example, let's consider something like line weight. This is a course I started teaching, again, at University at Buffalo. These drawings are done by William Sedig. A course I'll kind of continue to teach. It's titled How to Draw Exactly Wrong. So when we kind of mine these precise mistakes, or let's say lack of conventions, how can we begin to mine other qualities? Like flattening an object entirely to begin to perceive it, let's say, as a plan, as opposed to an axonometric projection. It also lends itself to revisiting precedent, which is very important to us, and potentially narrows our audience, at times, I think it's necessary, especially in an audience like this. So here we see William's drawing where he, I think, forces you to rethink the conceit of John Haydock's original drawing. the line no longer divides two masses, but rather fuses them. Here we explore the stubbornness of a sphere and present it alongside a context of other shapes that do oblige their projections. The sphere is still a sphere, but it's unwilling to play along with the rest of the characters. And it's kind of through this that maybe we start to involve persona in something bland, like just staring at shapes. But you find that in certain projections, that sphere is also capable of transforming itself, but potentially exhibiting unsphere-like qualities. So this is a drawing style called a soldierly perspective, or you're probably more familiar with it as an oblique parallel projection. This is an example of a collaboration I've done outside of the practice with a colleague, Sarah Blankenbaker, where we'll couple, again, these kind of drawing studies with short essays. Again, I don't feel like I can write at length, so I need to supplement the lack of writing with drawings. And so in this exercise, which we titled Who's Afraid of Micromegas, we explored some of the things that we were exploring in those previous examples I showed, but that Daniel Libeskind was certainly exploring in this set. And that is the value of toying with drawn convention. So we begin to tease out, let's say, moments from the set where objects change course mid-object, where section cuts disregard positions in space, and when dash lines are foregrounded. Again, total inside baseball architecture jargon. But it helps us, I think, take the next leap toward something like building, which you may see in some of the more built work. Again, in this realm of writing and drawing and trying to kind of guide the discipline through that avenue, we were recently asked to do a set of drawings for the recent publication of Log, titled New Ancients. And the set of drawings, along with the essay, we titled Five Self-Portraits. And we kicked it off with a one-liner that reads, self-promotion begins with self-image. So within the Renaissance, you'll find a lot of these canonical painters producing self-portraits of themselves, unsolicited. In other cases, you'll find them masking, you know, their visage into the paintings which are commissioned by others. In any case, we thought it would be interesting and funny to ask five buildings to kind of do the same thing, but rather try and derive their technique, whether it be compositional or geometric, through the lens of these five canonical self-portraits. So with that, we developed five characters, a palace we call the allegorist, an archway we call the egotist. And again, you see again the recycled imagery from a previous eye exam as the imaginist, a portico as the introvert, and a castle as the nativist. Here you see them more closely. This is Luca Cambiasso's self-portrait of the painter painting a portrait of his father. But we always kind of misread it as Cambiasso just painting himself in the future. And so kind of toying with the conceit of anamorphic projection, whereby a device can reconstruct a whole, we present, again, the two bell towers in two separate, let's say, states. Here you see the ecotist, essentially an archway that has been mapped to a cylinder that is starting to bow out as if it has a pot belly. Here, I don't think you can read it so clearly, but the nativist, what's compelling about this drawing, this is probably, I think, the most one we looked like closely in terms of technique, but rather it's not a two-point perspective, but rather Piero della Francesca's The Resurrection on the left is two one-point perspectives which are collapsed together. So you have a vanishing point that strikes Christ's face, and then one that hits the center of the sarcophagus. Piero has mapped his own face onto the face of the sleeping soldier on your left. And then we ask this tower, this turret from a castle, to kind of do the same thing. And by borrowing those techniques from Piero, the castle is able to, let's say, fight the picture plane and try to pop. And it's these sorts of exercises which force us to reconsider representation. Is the representation of the thing more important than the thing itself? So similar to a self-portrait or a selfie where you're trying to show the best side of yourself and get people to like you or get people to be interested in you, can representation kind of do this to almost banal building types? Again, another drawing I'll get into a little bit more detail. In collaboration with Ignacio Gigalan, we were invited to produce a set of drawings that were part of his exhibition in the Arsenale at this year's Venice Architecture Biennale. We produced four drawings for him, all based on his research, or not so much based on his research, but rather guided by his research on Cinecittà, which is movie city. Kind of the universal studios of Italy, built during the fascist regime, Mussolini. And the drawing I'll focus on here was the one on the left, which I just started with. But essentially, Ignacio asked us to produce an entry drawing, a drawing that would kind of illustrate this kind of canonical entrance to the film studios. And largely his research, and I won't get into too much detail because it's his project. I'll try to just focus on the technique by which we attack the drawing. His research was largely about the fictions that are kind of hidden behind this wall. And so it was very important for us to try in some way, again, through this kind of commission project, take on that charge. And so another technique we'll like to mine, because maybe this content is kind of dry for us, is kind of the act of splicing imagery. And so the first image that came to mind as we were beginning to talk about entrance and kind of theatricality and fiction was, again, a very familiar drawing, I hope, which is Sebastiano Serlio's set for a tragic scene. I think what's kind of compelling about this drawing is that, according to Serlio, tragedy only happens in palazzi. So the technique was rather simple. It was essentially an act of copying and tracing and modeling. So here you see us trying to float kind of the very kind of canonical figure of the Cinecittà profile into the drawing. Of course, the proportions of Serlio's drawing didn't necessarily work with what we were trying to do, so it forced us to make some proportional adjustments to the drawing in order to essentially construct a stage set, much in the same way that Serlio's treatise was meant to act as an illustrated guide for architects. And in a very painstaking manner, you model images from a photograph. You essentially kind of model your work off of the Serlio drawing, and you start to splice them. And so you can see here in the center an axonometric view of that set. And here kind of the final image, a little de Carico styling in the middle. So again, not to beat a dead horse, but we often, and Tom always makes fun of me, not make fun of me, but rather reminds me that Mask of Medusa was like on his book when he was a student, like no big deal. But I and some of my colleagues are beginning to recuperate, I think, this work in maybe a similar way of our peers. And this is a good one-liner I like, and I often use it to describe why we are no longer interested in taking on things like competitions at this point. And if we do, and when we often fail as we do, we tend not to refer to them as failed competition entries, but rather as successful drawing projects. And we try to tease out some possibilities from those failures. So I'll show you a failed competition entry, and that's the only, let's say, speculative project I'll show you, and the rest will be built, which I'm kind of excited to show. So this was a competition entry we did in 2012 for the Land Art Generator Initiative. Essentially, the goal was, it's very simple, to combine art and sustainability somewhere in Staten Island. If you look up the project, I believe Field Operations is taking on the master plan of that work. The idea was to try and produce something light, quick, again, this sort of like fast and frugal architecture that could also produce energy. And so we started with that conceit very earnestly. And we explored the two, I would say, canonical forms of generating wind energy. And those are the horizontal axis wind turbine, which you see on your right, and the vertical axis wind turbine, which you see on your left. And not so much as an act of subversion, but rather an act of looking closely and maybe seeing what someone else misses. What happens if we were essentially to propose a prototype that was more flexible, more mobile, and that offered an axis that I think most engineers tend to miss, which is the normal axis, which when applied to a balloon offers an infinite array of opportunities. Maybe that's overstating. Maybe engineers have already considered this and found out what we found, which it's super inefficient. Just a quick touch on some of, let's say, the graphic design sensibilities we work with. We often just choose the dumbest type to work with. And we often lay out our boards like children's books. I know Kohlhaas has the market on like book presentations, but I don't know if he's taken over kids' books. So I don't think you can see it here, but rather than showcasing a set of site plans with a caption that reads site plans, we'll often just, you know, mention a one-liner. Like, I think what reads under the child running through the field holding these balloons is the girl was unaware of the growing dandelions. And then we'll go from there. At other points of the board, yes, it gets more earnest and more technical and proves a very important point, I think, to this project, is that it is highly inefficient. But we use inefficiency, I think, in this sense as an opportunity. It's an opportunity to talk about quantity. So it takes, I think, 70 of our balloons to produce the same amount of wind energy that five horizontal axis wind turbines would produce. But with that, with more balloons, you get more opportunities to produce, I think, clusters and other, let's say, arrangements. Again, they are light. They do not take up the same sort of foundation that vertical and horizontal wind axis turbines do. They're playful, and maybe this is what returns us back to that first image that introduced the project, which is an image from the film Around the World in 180 Days, which is a film based entirely on a misreading of a book, whereby Phileas Fogg does not take the journey by balloon, but rather we love the misreading and love this notion that we're kind of obsessed with, let's say, floating masses and begin to kind of work off of that observation. Again, here, say, always trying to, let's say, compete with scale and produce, let's say, the illusion based on depth perception and trying to, let's say, resize these to maybe a more childlike form. Almost finally. So the most primitive definition of building is a structure with a roof and walls. And the next projects I show you do not have roofs. One has walls, but not load-bearing. In this act, again, we are still kind of developing as a practice and trying to showcase how these experiments translate into something three-dimensional. Again, we're still conceiving them as drawings. But again, through the translation, trying to mine, let's say, other effects. So on my way out of the States and to Rome, I was finishing up this project in 2013 with the help of Ryan Palliter and Damian Babbitts, where we were asked to compete in another maybe silly competition, but to take a tequila barrel and make it into art. And so our first attempt was to make it not look like a tequila barrel, and just a very kind of plain shape that we could essentially kind of graft something onto it. So the first exercise was to see if you could transition compression rings to tension rings and see if it would still hold up, and it did just fine, which is great. And then the next was to begin the toy with, again, a very familiar, almost iconic image. You know, we often refer to this as the figure ground vase. And it dates back to 1915, again, a drawing developed by a psychologist. And we find that with a little tweaking, a little disregard for symmetry, you can begin to not just produce character, but maybe emotion. So here you see that paint job, thanks to Ryan. Very close colleague, UIC, the kind of the normal side. And the trick here was, again, maybe mapping onto a convex surface. And as you walk around the object, essentially it starts to mutate. And again, this maybe ties back to our obsession with, let's say, returning the extraordinary back to ordinary. Just by walking around the object, it would just dumb itself down. Okay, onto some walls. This is a project we conceived of alongside parents of some preschoolers for the Early Learning Foundation in Chicago. It was a playhouse. Again, it was more of a design build project, largely driven by these icons. We were obsessed with three types of shapes: animals, stars, and lucky charms. And their ability to, let's say, reduce themselves down to, let's say, more primitive geometries. So our clients were 2 to 4 year olds, about 3 feet tall, and they played in a room that was quite fun. This is the site plan of the playroom. And our site was to wrap a playhouse around an existing column in the space. It's a very simple conceit. We made the column fat and began to take advantage of that thickness with some mobile play shapes that were able to be plugged back in to kind of close up the column back to its original thickness, or new original thickness, and explode out to begin to, let's say, take over the playroom. Again, here you start to see how those play shapes, the ones that are able to shift away from the column, also start to match up with the relief pattern you're starting to see. Those shapes exploded. We had this grand idea of allowing the children to go all the way up to the roof, but that quickly got nixed. And there's only a single platform inside where the students are able to perform puppet shows through some of the openings. Either way, it was a really fun project done on a very modest budget, and I think a lot of the effort was just placed on trying to produce this, I would call it somewhat of like a gestalt technique, whereby we'd see if the children would be able to, through their kind of short vantage point, conceive of this evolution of a shape from something that is that's somewhat primitive to something that is very figural. And in doing so, and kind of playing with a narrowing line of sight, those shapes would not only decrease in scale as they move vertically, but also start to become more surface. So the shapes at the bottom really start to project out, have more of a tactile quality because the kids can only touch so high. So there's no real need for them to touch above, although we wanted them to climb on it like a climbing wall. To date, this is the only project we've done that has color in it. And those colors were selected by the parents, and we were happy to oblige. Just happy to get the opportunity to build this thing. And use it as an exercise to see how the observer applies the methods we've been studying. I think they're having fun. Again, these photos were taken by a close friend, Matthew Mesner. Okay, onto some chairs. So several of our projects have begun with a fascination with just a single image. In this case, it was a plan view of a continuous bowback American Windsor chair. In other words, I think a forgettable chair entirely. But that said, it's not a forgettable image. If you look closely, you'll notice that one of the back spindles is missing. It's got a gapped tooth, you can see there on the left. And here is where I think our fascination with error, the wrong, persists. So you obsess about an image, and then you have to figure out how to reconstruct it. I think I should preface by saying that we're not furniture designers nor inventors. So we were simply using furniture to, I think, synthesize an architectural conceit, bent on vision, bent on drawing. So in our eyes, it was important to find great case studies to copy. In this case, it was these very carefully measured and redrawn shop drawings by this guy named Dr. John Kissay. And they're all, you can take a look at these drawings in the book of American Windsor Furniture, Styles and Technologies. But I think what was important is that we didn't take into account every drawing within his exquisite shop drawing set. Yes, we did at a certain point in order to, let's say, get profiles right for legs and back spindles, but we really just focused on the front elevation. It's as if giving your students in any of your design studios the task of designing in one view within their CAD software. And so everything was kind of guided by a frontal view. And so we produced these kind of mixed media collages of Kassé's drawings kind of very quickly. And then obviously had to translate these into three dimensions. And so here you can start to see a range of, exercises we begin to perform. So there's not a single error that's attached to one of the chairs, but rather a medley. So there's a series of things that happen, some that are more subtle in the case of the chair on your right, where one of the spindles is kinked by like 15 degrees. That's a pretty obvious one. It's actually Carrie's favorite chair. My least favorite, just for that fact that it is too obvious and you get it right away. The chairs were fabricated by kind of an interesting technique as a collaboration with Reeves Rash of Rash LLC in Burlington, Kentucky. He's also known for doing Jimenez Lai's White Elephant. Reeves had never worked with wood before, so it was also a really fun project to tackle together. So I basically became his assistant for a week. Reeves, however, was not too interested in turning spindles, so that we were able to kind of contract out to third generation wood turners living just across the river in Cincinnati. I'm gonna go ahead and go through these chairs individually, but needless to say, just to give you a little backstory of why the American Windsor chair makes sense, because it is maybe the dumbest chair to conceive of and actually build. Everything plugs into the seat, okay? So as someone who's not an expert in furniture design nor construction, it was a very simple kit of parts to put together. And it was a combination of both analog and digital techniques, something that we try to mine and mask equally within a lot of our projects. So because we were limited to a three-axis mill, we were only able to carve, let's say, two sides of the seats, and then very manually drill with several jigs the kind of holes where the back spindles and the legs would plug in. So again, a drawing exercise, but instead of on paper or on the computer, done on wood. Here you see an example of the jig being used to drill. And on the right, one of the wood turners in his shop. By the way, if you ever need wood turned, definitely go to Cincinnati. Okay. So here, I'm going to just walk you through some of the chairs and some of the moves that are going on in them. So with the settee, it was really important, again, for us to privilege, in this case, not just a front view, but a side view for the chair and begin to collapse two drawings into one. So you'll start to see there are certain issues that arise, how to negotiate, let's say, the two legs in the center. What that essentially does, I think, for its chairness, it's meant to be a bench, it's meant to be a two-seater. It ends up forcing your loved one or stranger to sit a little bit closer to you. In this case, with a comb-back side chair, Carrie's favorite. It touched on one of our other kind of drawing interests, which is the notion of shadow play. It's a little light here, but you can see that, let's say, fixed shadow have been cast and then etched into the seat of the chair, so as to kind of float an unfamiliar scene within a gallery space or a room of any sort. Here, again, this one, I think, starts to toy with, let's say, over-structuring something, which you may see in the high chair, but to produce an effect that forces the observer to walk around the chair before sitting in it. So it's kind of this kind of 360-degree courtship with an object, and one that is seemingly trying to be symmetrical about its seat, but in the end cannot. This one, a student yesterday asked me, are all of these kind of tricks just aesthetic, right? Like, or are they all just visual? Like, what happens when you begin to consider them outside of, let's say, that valuation? Well, this is an example I think I shared with her yesterday of where the tactile does become, let's say, a consequence of a visual game. So here, an interest in approximated curvature, whereby a series of straight lines are meant to replicate the smoothness of the original chair. There is a tactile effect that happens. Now you sit on the chair and your right side is conscious of that right side. And again, matched with a less subtle trick of a kinked leg. Funny enough, this was the chair we had to modify the least. It is a desk chair, so it wasn't designed to be positioned with a table, like a table at this height. So rather at its original height, it would clash with the table, so it just had to be lifted up. So again, that error was only a desire so the object might float, let's say, a redundant table over an existing one. In addition, the knob is fake, and there are some, let's say, anamorphic carvings that are happening on the top of the top crest rail, whereby, again, forcing you to walk around the object. Here, kind of a dangerous-looking high chair. By tripling the structure, you produce the illusion of, I think, a stepladder a child might use to access the high chair on his or her own. It also, I think, starts to simulate the same visual game that a Necker cube might, in that it tends to be reversible from the front view just by omitting a piece, because we didn't really know how to steam bend wood at the time. Let's say a lack of skill turns into an opportunity. Lastly, a chair we spent a lot of time just crafting immaculately and then very carefully, just inserting the most subtle, let's say, illusion of, let's say, poor structure. And that essentially becomes kind of the set, I think, a set of chairs that at the end of the day are just chairs, a set of, let's say, visual tricks that go blank once they're seated. They just return to being chairs. Despite this poor structure, it still stands. And with the exception of, let's say, one chair, which was designed to wobble, they're all level. So I think in terms of that spectrum I described, vision, drawing to building, it would sort of end there, the practice. Like, we don't have more built works yet to show you. We're working on it right now. But we've begun to kind of rethink that that spectrum and maybe reconsider the drawing, let's say this kind of middle game, as the game itself. And so this is a quotation from a good friend of ours, Jaffer Kolb, who's writing the introduction to a small monograph we're putting together, or treatise, rather. And it's this consideration of technique and process all in the kind of effort toward, let's say, a grander project, when maybe that project is right in front of you. Again, it's one that's very familiar, I think, to architects, but it's a project that's maybe concerned with this idea of freeing the drawing from the picture plane. So right now in Syracuse, I'm teaching a visiting critic studio where one of the exercises is a drawing exercise. The students were asked to produce forced perspectives or anamorphic projections that would be able to reposition themselves around the architecture school, so as to, again, float a familiar scene and start to ask passersby to kind of reconsider the spaces that they're very familiar with. So the more banal, the better. I had kids like putting their canvases in front of water fountains, for example. In addition to that, considering the drawing, let's say, as the project, as the artifact itself, every time we exhibit the chairs, and there's really only been three occasions, we've tried to couple the chairs with a drawing. The first time the chairs were exhibited, again, they were done as part of a fellowship and with the support of the University of Buffalo School of Architecture and Planning. They were first exhibited around a drawn table. I had run out of money to make a table, and it turns out that maybe not having a table was actually, again, a nice opportunity. So again, here, place settings were all kind of carved out, and they were laminated to the floor. Again, here you're starting to see people occupy the chairs. And it was kind of interesting because while you could have thought that they were conceived to be a set, they were all actually conceived like quite individually and independent from one another. So it was only up until this point where we have to surround them around a table. It starts to maybe mimic, and for lack of a better reference, like anthropomorphic qualities. I do think the chairs start to take on personas, which is something which wasn't designed for or that we're necessarily interested in at this point in the practice. But it was... it was interesting to start to see them more as a set. They're now being represented by a gallery in Chicago called Volume. And in this occasion, we were able to exhibit them all individually. So it's kind of up to, let's say, a buyer to, let's say, put a set together. And here, as I showed maybe in that first plan view, we drew the walls of a white wall gallery that we would have liked to maybe exhibit the chairs in. And it ends up working kind of to your advantage because now you can see through walls and see all chairs simultaneously. But at the same time, if you're to maybe conceive of those 45-degree projected thick lines as walls, you may start to kind of frame your view one chair at a time. And we actually found that during the opening, it actually it curated circulation through the room, which is a really nice after effect. But then the moment like I stepped over one, like everyone started to do it, which was kind of funny. Most recently, just in June, we were given the opportunity, in addition to lecture with the Architecture League of New York, but to exhibit two of the chairs again. And you always use that as an opportunity, I think, to take on new work. So here we projected a view one would have from a very famous gallery within a not so famous gallery. Not to say that the Aronson Gallery isn't fantastic. We had a great time there. You can't quite compare it to the Whitney. And to this image, which we really loved, the image of Marcel Breuer in front of the trapezoidal window facing West Madison. And what's kind of lovely about it is all of the detail in that image comes from the very banal residential building that's on the other side of the street. So that's, I think, where the focus starts, and you have to then draw your eyes back. So in many ways, it was about not calling attention to our chairs, but calling attention to the wall, then to the frame, and then back to the chair. We tried to even simulate the light effect that one would have, again, by using this technique of drawing on the floors, and again, simulating in a, let's say, a three-dimensional environment digitally, and then trying to reconceive of that in the space. So again, here you see white shadow projections now being cast from this false window. I'll just quickly show kind of two more projects, one of which I hold, well, both of which I now hold dear to my heart, but one that really inspired a lot of, let's say, this this meticulous technique, which I didn't explain in the previous project, but will showcase here, of drawing directly on a wall. We got really obsessed with frescoes while in Rome. I think it's the closest you can get to a wall, and not really affect the building, so let's say, you know, structure. So here the title of this project is A View into the Arthur and Janet C. Ross Library Without Books. And we were very lucky to get permission by the American Academy in Rome, more specifically by Christina Pulisi, the boss, to draw on a wall in a very peculiar hallway in this space. So again, if you take a quick look at this diagram here, you'll see that the rectangle, the very thin and tall rectangle, is adjoining this kind of arched figure on the right. The figure on the left is a 100-foot hallway that spans about, it's about 20 feet tall, and adjoins, or abuts rather, the Arthur and Janet C. Ross Library. So here you see a view of the hall. On the left side are scholars' offices. And on the right is just a blank wall, very much an afterthought. But in the actual original plans of the McKim, Mead, and White building, you'll realize that I guess when you're trying to replicate a Renaissance villa, you tend to focus mainly on the front and not necessarily consider some of these interior moments. That said, the library space is quite exquisite, and what we were trying to do is through drawing, again, drawing is building, is connect the two visually. And again, so through kind of rigorous measuring, we were able to produce a three-dimensional kind of digital environment that related the two spaces in proportion and in detail. So here you see the view we were after, the ability to look through the wall and onto the space below. And here you see the actual drawing, which again is kind of defined as an anamorphic projection, whereby an oblique vantage point allows you to reconstruct an image. So the drawing runs about 32 feet in length. It's about 10 feet tall. And as you can see, the distortion increases as you move from left to right. So to just fast forward, Carrie flies into Rome and doesn't spend a day in Rome, but 7 days in this hallway with me. God bless her. Whereby we meticulously traced over and onto graphite paper, onto this surface, and then went over it with ink. And here you start to see how difficult it is to photograph in this space. A detail shot. And as you kind of get closer, and the beautiful thing was that you could, from a certain vantage point, you wouldn't even be able to necessarily take in all of that detail, but upon getting closer to that right side of the drawing, I think you would start to maybe appreciate what you were looking at. here, I'll just simulate what would happen if you were to, starting to slow down. Kind of shift your gaze from the optimal vantage point down to maybe a child's height. And here again is that maybe passage through the corridor. Let's see if that's playing. Here you see the same passage from the height of a 3-foot person. And then finally, quickly just gonna end on the most recent, let's say, drawing is building project that we've worked on. It was a kind of quick project we did for this yearly event that the Architectural League puts on. It's called the Beaux-Arts Ball. They invited 9 graphic designers, artists, and artists to let's say, look closely at this late 19th century Beaux-Arts Savings Bank in Williamsburg, Brooklyn. And after a brief site visit, come up with an idea for a digital projection that would be animated and span, let's say, on repeat the duration of a party. So here you see the 3 surfaces that the company Nuit Blanche New York would essentially project your view onto. So it's kind of a strange, let's say, canvas to work with, essentially an arch and 2 pendentives. But it was a let's say, an interesting exercise to, let's say, in Carrie's case, because she did the site visit, walk around the building and take in, let's say, some element of the building that you would want to project back onto the building. That was essentially the charge. The title of the theme of the event was craft. And so we, in a very kind of quick and maybe similarly pick the dumb balloon option, just went for the biggest space in the bank, and that was the dome. And this was our pitch, was that it hurts our necks to look at intricacy from below, and we'd rather rotate it on its side. And that's kind of it. Again, similar to, let's say, the wall drawing at the American Academy in Rome, you have to, I think the design decisions come with how much work you actually want to do. And what, from that vantage point and that scale, is going to be visible, right? So you try to draw and take in as much detail that I think you'll find, let's say, noticeable. So in this case, the idea was to kind of reconstruct the dome and a majority of its fresco and begin to toy with lens length and focus. So really quickly, I'll kind of walk through some of the stills. The animation that we would produce, essentially, that would then get projected and cropped onto the arch and pendentive. And finally, a view from the party. I think at the end of the day, this game of Eyecon just aims to collapse the divisions that exist between the observer and the observed in order for us, the architect, to gauge and mine new visual literacy. Thank you.
Trying to do something right, and we're trying to do a right detail. the sort of editing process that goes into our ideas, how we sort of assess what's good, what's super sweet. You've got a slightly different problem, which is you're trying to find things that are interestingly wrong. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about your editing process, both in terms of as you're producing what you're looking at, what makes a perfectly wrong chair. I imagine there must be dozens of wrong chairs that weren't wrong enough or sure. too wrong. And also, if you could flip that around and talk a little bit about how you look at historic examples and what you think inspires you, for instance, about a Serlio perspective that maybe didn't about another perspective from the same era.
So the first question is, how do we define wrong?
Well, they're both sort of questions about editing. What do you look for that makes something perfectly wrong? And then also going back, what makes something worthy of kind of inspiration?
Right. So for a talk that was supposed to be all about, let's say, method and techniques, I think that answer requires the most intuition. I think we're still developing kind of sets of valuations and criteria, both in terms of, let's say, historical source material and the qualifications of what constitutes, let's say, exactly wrong. In most cases, I think it is a game of subtlety that is liminal. And so at times, I think at certain scales, you begin to desire kind of the overt, let's say, error. And at others, you may kind of flip that. But as far as editing, I don't think, I mean, it's difficult, right? Because at the end of the day, you're trying to kind of avoid being pigeonholed, and that every project kind of requires this this terminology or this valuation, right? Is it good if it doesn't exhibit some sort of error? And I would say, again, maybe to relinquish the specificity of the term and maybe just think about it more counterintuitively. And that maybe that hallway isn't necessarily wrong, right? But it could be better. It's like the editing question.
Is it money, or is it the fact that it's too much time spent, or is it
that's a good question.
The fact that nobody's gonna actually see them?
That's a great question. And unfortunately one that has a very simple answer, which is time. And I think that's a nice thing. And this is something actually, maybe an important thing to touch on, which is the notion of I've always conceived of drawing as, or drawings rather, as always exhibiting a state or quality of being unfinished at all times. I think it's the reason why I got a tattoo when I was just finishing architecture school, because it was one drawing I knew I would leave alone and presume was precise and finished. And I never want to add to it. And that's difficult, because I do think that takes restraint, right? Because sometimes I do want to add to the tattoo. But I think there's something about, let's say, trusting that gut or that intuition that initiated that kind of response that maybe allows you to just find another problem to tackle. Or how it will be perceived as a whole?
Because your eyes coordinate, like I know biologically eyes coordinate things in a certain way, but all of us have our own perspectives on things.
Oh, sure.
So how do you, like where does your we made those chairs, because you said that they weren't specifically meant to be, you know, together and have that persona, but people gave it that persona.
Sure. Right. No, I think it. That's a good question. I think it. I think it is a problem every architect has to deal with. This notion of, are you designing for oneself or an audience? And we hope that it's for an audience, but in most cases, it is a personal exercise that happens, and you can only predict how an audience might receive it, which is why you need to produce more work and continue to maybe track those responses. I think it's super ambitious to presume that we're all going to read things identically. That's actually horrific, right? I don't want to think that way. So in many ways, I think it is about, let's say, designing for a little bit of error that you found interesting, or simulating an illusion that you found compelling, but towards another end, I think. And that's something which we're trying to tackle right now. I know when I say that maybe the game is the end game, I think that is the case maybe right now. I don't think I'm tied to that like a doctrine. I do think that there are going to be other qualities to observe from the work that we will try and curate, but again, mainly try and step back and just observe. Of course, thank you. Yes?
I have a quick question about the visual literacy.
Quick question.
Mm-hmm. When you get to the paper, it has a point and moment that becomes the immeasurable visual literacy, and then it goes back to measurable visual literacy. Create a product. But because it's very difficult for me to be visually literate the whole time.
To visually what?
Be visually literate.
Sure. It's like the Elazitsky problem. I think we're excited when maybe errors emerge from the translation. And that's another thing we're beginning to mine. But as far as, as far as mining that, the image of, let's say, the measurable product, I think, we're again just left to, this issue of like how educated the audience might be with regard to certain drawings. So like in another audience, I may have to go into more detail with regard to axonometric projection. I can sidestep maybe that in this crowd because I presume that you understand that projection, and maybe we can begin to talk about something else. In the same way, it may be really boring, right, for you and for another audience to even consider that more carefully, right? But I think that's maybe when the content comes in. So maybe I riff too long on how I really like to play with exploded view drawings. But maybe because I introduce it through a toy cabin, you might find that compelling. So you begin, I think, to package the work in different ways to different audiences, with, different tendencies with regard to their visual literacy. In many ways, I think it's about resetting as a collective, like as an audience, and maybe considering that for a moment, all of the information to kind of get the work is right in front of you. There's nothing more, right? You don't need to know who Sir Leo is. You don't need to know what a Lincoln log cabin is originally scaled at, to take something away. And I think that's when the work gets exciting.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.